Finally, what we did last time was we imagined representing each of these vectors in a v-dimensional vector space where v is the size of the vocabulary. Okay, so think of a v-dimensional vector space where each of the axes correspond to one of the terms in the vocabulary. So there are v-axes and each document is a point in this v-dimensional space. Okay, so it's just like, you know, when you had your high school coordinate geometry, you would have an x coordinate, you would have a y coordinate, and you would have a z coordinate for a point in three-dimensional space. In a similar way, for a point in v-dimensional space, these are the coordinates for representing the location of that document. So either you can think of a document as represented by, you know, the set of v coordinates, or you can think of it as represented by the vector from the origin up to that point. Okay, so that would be like the representation x1 I cap plus y1 j cap plus z1 k cap in your, you know, high school vector algebra. Okay, so this would be that vector. But of course here v will be very high. There'll be tens of millions of dimensions. And these are going to be very sparse vectors. That is, most of these values, most of these TF-IDF weights are going to be zero. Why are they going to be zero? Because a document can have only on an average a few thousand terms, whereas this vocabulary size is going to be tens of millions of terms. And so most of those terms are not going to appear in a single document. And so for that document, most of these coordinates are going to be zero. Now we can think of the query itself as a short document. Okay, we can think of the query itself as a short document, and we can map that query itself into that v-dimensional space. And then we're going to look at the distance between the query and all the documents in that space. The closest document to the query is going to be the one that will have the highest score. Okay, so again, we're going to try to come up with a scoring scheme. And in fact, we already have a scoring scheme, which is that we simply add the TF-IDF weights. Okay, this was the scoring scheme we saw before we looked at this vector representation. And this corresponds to just looking at the terms in the query and looking at the corresponding components of the vector. Okay, so if, for example, the query is capital of India, and in the vector representation, let's say capital appears in the second position, of appears in the fifth position, and India appears in the 100th position. What we're going to do is we're going to look at the TF-IDF weights for all the documents at these three locations and add them up. Okay, that's what we are doing in terms of operations on vectors. So here's another way to look at it. Represent the query as 1, 1, 1 for all the terms that are in the query and make the rest of the entries 0. Okay, so this is capital. Okay, this is position number 3 here. This is position number 6, and this is position number 9. Okay, so represent the query as this particular vector, which will have a 1 for all the terms that are in the query, and represent each document as a vector of TF-IDF weights, and then take the dot product of these two vectors. Okay, what happens when you take the dot product? What is the dot product between two vectors? Well, you multiply the vectors component-wise, and then you add the result. Okay, so the dot product is a single number, and in this case 0 will be multiplied by whatever the TF-IDF weight for this particular term is in that document. This 0 will get multiplied with some value here. So all of those values are going to be 0. This 1 will get multiplied with the TF-IDF weight for capital, this one will get multiplied with the TF-IDF weight for off, and this one will get multiplied with the TF-IDF weight for India, and then you're going to add up those three weights. So by taking the dot product of the query vector with the document vector, you get the value of this score. Now why would you, let's look at some other ways to compute the proximity between the query and the document. One is to just take the dot product. Here's another idea we looked at. We thought, why not look at the Euclidean distance between the query and the document. Right, and do you remember what was the problem with that? If we work with Euclidean distance. Okay, this is a different scoring scheme from what we just saw. What we just saw was a scoring scheme where you just take the dot product, which was equivalent to evaluating that formula. Now we are talking about a scoring scheme where we are computing the Euclidean distance between the query and all the documents and then ranking them in decreasing order of that distance. Now for simplicity's sake, okay, here's just to keep things a little simple, I'm going to assume that in the TF-IDF weight, the IDF is of course log of n by df for that particular term. So for the term frequency component, instead of working with 1 plus log of the term frequency, let's just work with the term frequency itself. Okay, because it will help us to, making this simplification will help us understand a concept that's just coming up. So, why is the Euclidean distance a bad idea? We were looking at the end of the last class at an example of two documents, D and D prime, where D prime is just D appended to itself two times. Okay, so every single word that appears in D appears twice in D prime. So what would be the relationship between the TF-IDF vector for D prime and the TF-IDF vector for D? Anybody want to answer this? In terms of their vectors in this V-dimensional space, can you connect them using a simple formula? If document D prime is just D concatenated with itself. Firstly, let's think about this. Do you expect D prime to be more relevant to the query than D? Or do you expect both of them to have sort of the same relevance? Intuitively, I mean, just think about yourself as a user. Okay, you're typing in a query. There's one document and there's another document, and the second document is nothing but the first document just duplicated twice. And in this case, you know, this is a silly example because you'll say the second document is like a spam document, but hypothetically just think of it as a valid document. We'll look at spam later on. So both of these are conceptually or intuitively at the same distance from the query, right? They should be because they have the same content. There's no difference in the in their content. So what about their coordinates? What is the relationship between the two vectors for D prime and D? Or equivalently, what is the relationship between the two coordinates? Okay, so D prime is going to have, is going to be represented as a set of V coordinates, and D will be represented as a set of V coordinates. And you can think of them as basically a vector of those coordinates. So what's the difference between this D prime vector and this D vector? So is Charu Joshi there?
Yeah, d prime should be twice.
D should d prime will be twice
of d.
Twice of d. Yeah, and it'll be twice of d because yeah, you can turn off the microphone now. Yeah, both d prime and d are a vector of TF IDF weights. Now the IDF score, IDF part of their scores are exactly the same, right? If I take the first term here and I take the first term here, both are the same term, right? Because these are, they are the first component of the vector, right? These are lexicographically sorted, let's say, in and there are V of them. Okay, so this is, we're looking at the same term in both the vectors, and their TF IDF weights are going to be the same because the IDF weights are the same, and the term frequency weights in one are is twice that of the other. So the TF IDF weights are not the same actually, but they are twice the value in D prime. Okay, because as I said, we are looking just at the term frequency. Let's not look at the log frequency weighting, because if you look at the log frequency weighting, then it's not going to be twice. Okay, the relationship will be more complex. Okay, because you'll have this extra log base 10 of 2 in the TF weights, and taking the ratio is going to be harder. So the, rather than working with fractions, it'll be easier for us to work with real numbers. And so let's work with TF, and the TF is twice in D prime for every term that occurs in D prime. Okay, so this entire vector can be represented as twice of D. So if you take the Euclidean distance between Q and D, and if you take the Euclidean distance between Q and D prime, clearly they're going to be very different. Right? They're going to be significantly different in their values, because D prime is D, you know, taking the you take the vector D and then you double its length. And by doubling its length, you could go, even if D was close to Q, D prime would be pretty far from Q. So that's why Euclidean distance is not a good measure of the proximity between a query and a document. So here's what you can take away from this example. We don't want to treat D prime and D differently. Okay, we want to treat them as if they were, we want those two points to kind of coincide. Okay, because they are conceptually equally distant from any query, not just the query capital of India, but you take any query, if D prime is just D concatenated with itself, both should be equally far from every query. And so ideally they should coincide in that V-dimensional space. And what's a good way to make them coincide? Any guesses? Imagine another document, D double prime, which is three times, you know, three copies of D. You want all three of them to coincide. How do you represent these documents such that they will all three of them will coincide? Anybody has any ideas?
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, instead of considering the distance as we discussed last class, we can consider the angle itself. So, angle for all the three would be same.
Yeah, we can consider the angle itself because the angle is going to be the same. You're absolutely right. That's actually where we ended the last class. We saw that if this is D, then D prime is going to be like this. And so if the query is this vector, then the angle between the query and the document is going to be the same as the angle between the query and this other document. So that's one way to compute the score between the query and document. such that the length of the document itself is not significant, okay, because we are looking at the angle, we are not looking at the length of these vectors. So the lengths of the documents are not important. What's important is whether the proportions of terms in the query and the documents are close or not. If the proportions are the same, then both the query and the document will be located approximately in the same region in the v-dimensional space, right? Intuitively, that is. So if you compute the angle between the query and the document, then that angle will hopefully be small. But I'm actually asking something more simpler even before we do that. There's another way to look at this computation, which is that we won't represent d and d prime as these vectors. Let's take every document and convert it into a unit vector and then represent it in this v-dimensional space. Okay, suppose we take every document vector and normalize it, that is, divide the vector by its length. And you may remember that the length of a vector, could you turn off the microphone please? Yeah, so what is the length of a vector, or what is the magnitude of a vector? If you remember your high school geometry again, you would recall that in a three-dimensional space, x, where you have a coordinate x1, y1, z1, what is the distance between this coordinate and the origin? Well, it's square root of x1 square plus the square root of y1 square plus the square root of z1 square. Likewise, the distance between two vectors, x1, y1, z1 and x2, y2, z2 is square root of x1 minus x2 square plus the square root of y1 minus y2 square plus the square root of z1 minus z2 square. And that same formula can be extended into v dimensions. So if you have a v dimensional vector, the magnitude of that vector or the length of that vector is going to be the square root of the summation of the square of the individual components of that vector. Sometimes this is called as the norm of the vector or the magnitude of that vector. It's called the L2 norm because, you know, the L1 norm is just going to be, it's just going to be the sum of the coordinates, x, the magnitude of x1 plus the magnitude of y1 plus the magnitude of z1. By the way, one of the things to note is that all of these values are non-negative. Okay, they'll either be zero or they'll be positive numbers. You'll never have negative TF-IDF weights, right? Because the IDF score can't be negative since it's n divided by DF. And n is always greater than or equal to df. So if you take the log of n divided by df, the log will always be non-negative. And the TF score is always going to be positive. So in some way, all these vectors are located in the same quadrant. Okay, although quadrant is the wrong word to use here because we have more than two dimensions. We have millions and millions of dimensions. But you can, you know, take the analogous concept for that. For a quadrant. So they're all in the positive quadrant of this v-dimensional space. So if we divide a vector by its L2 norm, I was just mentioning why this L2 is there. So the L1 norm is defined to be the magnitude of x1, which is basically x1 because x1 is always positive, plus y1 plus z1. The L2 norm is the square root of x1 square plus y1 square plus z2 square. The L3 norm will be the cube root of x1 cube plus y1 cube plus z1 cube. Okay, and we're not going to worry about other norms. We are only concerned about the magnitude of the vector, which is given by the L2 norm. And this is something you can prove easily using simple Pythagoras theorem. You can prove that if you have a vector in three-dimensional space, this is the magnitude. Okay, that's high school geometry. So this is just an extension of that formula. So what we'll do is, we'll take every document vector and we will convert it into a unit vector. Okay, so a unit vector is nothing but a vector in the same direction as that document, but whose magnitude is 1. And how do you convert a vector into its unit vector? You take the vector and divide every component of that vector by its L2 norm. Okay, so if you want to convert x1, y1, z1 into a unit vector, the resulting vector will be x1 divided by summation of x1 square plus y1 square plus z1 square. The second coordinate will be y1 divided by the square root of x1 square plus y1 square plus z1 square. And the third component of that vector will be z1 divided by square root of x1 square plus y1 square plus z1 square. So you can see that the magnitude of this vector will be the square root of this. So what is the magnitude of this vector? It's the square root of x1 square plus y1 square plus z1 square. So the magnitude of this vector will be, you take the square of this, you add it to the square of this, you add it to the square of this, and then you take the square root. Okay, and if you take the square of this and add it to the square of this and the square of this, you'll get 1, because you'll have x1 square. The denominator will be just x1 square plus y1 square plus z1 square. And the numerator will be x1 square plus y1 square plus z1 square. And so the numerator and denominator will cancel each other out, and the magnitude is 1. Okay, so both d and d prime, when converted into their respective unit vectors, will become identical after this length normalization. So now, whether a document is long or short, it doesn't matter. If they have the same proportion of the words, their unit vectors will bring them very close to one another in this three-dimensional space. So having converted every document into its unit vector, we can now measure the angle between the unit vectors. And how do we measure the angle between two vectors? Well, what we strictly need is not exactly the angle. We need the distance between the query and the document, right? And the distance is now going to be proportionate to the angle. So the larger the angle, the larger the distance. Now, because this angle will always be between 0 and 90 degrees, okay, why is it going to be between 0 and 90 degrees? Because all your points are in the positive quadrant. All your points are in the positive quadrant, and so the angle is going to be between 0 and 90. Now, if you look at the value of cos theta as a function of theta, you can see that between 0 and 90 degrees, the value of cos theta starts at 1. So cos of 0 is 1. Cos of 90 degrees is 0. And between 0 and 90 degrees, the value of cos theta is going down, monotonically decreasing. So if instead of measuring this angle theta between Q and D, why not measure the cos of the angle between Q and D? Why do you want to measure the cos? Because it turns out that there is a very simple way to measure the cosine of an angle between two vectors. And again, if you remember your high school vector algebra, you would remember that the dot product of two vectors is nothing but the magnitude of the first vector multiplied by the magnitude of the second vector multiplied by cosine of the angle between the two vectors. So cos of theta, or cos of the angle between the two vectors, is nothing but the dot product of the two vectors divided by their magnitudes. And what are the magnitudes of the vectors we are looking at? They are 1 because they are unit vectors. You know, every single vector in this v-dimensional space is going to be a unit vector, including the query. We'll convert the query also into a unit vector. So these two are 1. So the cosine of the angle is nothing but the dot product between the query and the document after normalization. Okay, and this is very similar to the score that we were having earlier, except that this is more sophisticated because now we've added the third property we wanted, which was normalization. Right? Again, let's go back to the three desired properties of the scoring scheme. We've incorporated the term frequency in the TF score. We've incorporated the rarity of terms by giving them more weights in the IDF score. And now we are normalizing for lengths. We are making the lengths of documents irrelevant. Rather, what's more important is what is the mixture of terms that are appearing in that document in terms of percentages. You know, some last time somebody was talking about this roughly. Somebody proposed a scheme that was similar, not identical, but similar to it, where you look, you know, the person said that let's look at the percentage, the term percentage instead of the term frequency. This is something like that. We are normalizing in this vector space. And so the resulting scoring scheme, what will be the resulting scoring scheme? You take the original query. Okay, we'll take the original query and compute the cosine of the angle between the query and every single document in that vector space. And what do you mean by computing the cosine of the angle? Well, we are just computing the dot products. Okay, represent the query and every document as a unit vector. Then take the dot product between the query and every single document vector. Now, would a high cosine score indicate greater proximity or a low cosine score? Okay, we just saw the graph for the value of cosine theta between 0 and 90 degrees. You can see that if the angle between the query and the document, okay, so I'm just going to give you a break. I'll just finish with one or two, just one last point. The cosine between two, the cos of 0 is 1, right? Cos of 0 is 1. So if the query and the document have a very small angle between them, the value of cosine theta will be large. So you can use the cosine score as a measure of the proximity between the distance, between the query and the document. A larger cosine score indicates a smaller angle, and a smaller angle indicates greater proximity. Okay, so the larger the cosine score between the query and the document, the closer the query and the document are. Okay, so larger cosine scores indicate greater proximity. And smaller cosine scores indicate larger larger distance between the query and the document. So if we rank the documents in decreasing order of the angle between the query and the, actually not decreasing, let's say we rank the documents in increasing order of the angle between query and the document, right? This would be the ranked list that we would want in ranked retrieval. We want the closest document to be at the top. That would be equivalent to ranking the documents in decreasing order of cosine scores. Okay, because larger cosine scores are greater, indicating greater proximity. So let's take the largest, the document with the largest cosine score with respect to the query, and then rank it the highest. Okay, you can take a break now. I'll take up an example of that after we are back.